Is my PRP working? How long does it take? Will it work? I started noticing my hair loss around the beginning of April. It seemed suddenly thin all over. In May, I decided to start PRP treatment in my area. 2 months have passed, and I have since done 3 treatments. Today was my third, and I saw the progress pictures, and my hair didn't look any better, thinner even. How long until I see results? Should I be seeing them already?
Thank you for your question. You submitted a question without a photo, and you're asking this question, is your PRP working? And you describe in the text of your question that you had suddenly noticed significant hair thinning, and that you went ahead with the PRP treatment. And then you underwent a second one, and then at the time you submitted this question, you had undergone a third one. You feel that your progress photos do not show improvement. In fact, it appears that you are getting worse. So you're also asking, should this be working out this way? Will this PRP stimulate your hair growth? Should it already have had an effect on your hair growth? Well, I can certainly help you understand how I counsel patients who have hair loss in my practice and give you a sense of where this modality has a role and in what kind of strategy is employed. A little bit of background, I'm a board-certified cosmetic surgeon and fellowship-trained oculofacial plastic and reconstructive surgeon. I've been in practice in Manhattan and Long Island for over 20 years. Hair transplant and managing hair loss has been a very big part of my practice. In fact, I'm the founder of TrichoStem Hair Regeneration Centers, a system that we developed starting about 7 years ago using PRP and ACellular matrix to help men and women with hair loss, typically genetic pattern hair loss, non-surgically, and leveraging this concept of stem cell-based restoration of hair growth. And I'll go into details further. So to begin with, at the current state of knowledge and slow but steady acceptance of PRP as a modality for hair loss, I feel that there is still a lot of questions that do remain unresolved. And in medicine, that is often the reality. There are many things that clinically have benefit where at the basic science level, it is still difficult to fully explain the cause and effect and have the predictability. So the art of clinical medicine, of course, is to treat, observe, and extrapolate based on information and experience. Well, to go back to what we did with our procedure, hair regeneration, approximately 7 years ago when we were doing a lot of transplants, we were using a combination of platelet-rich plasma and a material called acellular matrix, which is a wound-healing material to help improve the graft survival as well as improve the healing of the donor area, both which were always challenges with hair transplant. Well, a beneficial side effect was that thinning hair appeared to grow thicker. And that thinning hair that grew thicker occurred long after the procedure was completed and the material was placed. So we took it upon ourselves to explore the opportunity to see if we can have a process where we can treat hair thinning with a non-surgical approach rather than allow the hair to go away and then keep doing transplants. Well, to make a long story short, we were very successful with this. We developed hair regeneration and then the company TrichoStem Hair Regeneration. We treat patients from all over the world, and what that has meant is that we have so much volume of patients with a wide range of ages and conditions such that I've been able to really define different subgroups of people and how they respond. Globally speaking, that the overwhelming majority of our patients have benefit from this treatment sustainable for 5 years, and that is both men and women. Now, within these groups, however, there are going to be certain groups of patients that have more aggressive hair loss patterns. Generally speaking, these tend to be younger people who have had an early onset, so maybe teens and 20s, and who have very rapid progression. Now, when we think about that scenario, we also have to look at what are the known associated causes or interventions that are available to medically treat hair loss. Well, there is finasteride, the drug, an oral drug that is a DHT blocker or dihydrotestosterone, and then there's minoxidil. When we think about hair loss, it's very important to understand that hair loss is still a progressive condition. And regardless of what modality is being used, there is no current cure for genetic pattern hair loss. There are strategies to slow it down and prolong the lifespan of the hair and therefore provide longer coverage, as well as the surgical strategy, which is to place grafts of hair in places which need that area to provide coverage. So it gets down to basically providing coverage. Now, one of the things that I find that a lot of people who are relatively new to this world of stem cell-based hair loss treatment is that when you don't really do hair loss management as a long-term strategy, a lot of times people are taking, for lack of a better phrase, a shotgun approach. And I'm not saying this is the situation for you, but a lot of people who are relatively new to this are getting excited because they go to meetings, they see good results with PRP, and they decide they're going to add that to their practice. And then when people aren't doing well, they shrug their shoulders. The challenge with hair loss management is understanding really what the likely prognosis is for an individual's clinical picture. Now, you described a scenario where you had suddenly had significant thinning. Well, that is unusual unless it's more like the typical awareness of significant thinning. There's a difference. There's the awareness of significant thinning is often occurs when people think they have more hair than they do, and then suddenly they realize, wow, they have barely any scalp coverage, or they get a view of the top of their head from a mirror or a photo or something, and then feel like, oh, suddenly I've lost my hair. When a lot of times it's been progressing along, but because their view that when they look in the mirror, they could see a frontal hairline and they look pretty good, they don't realize how much hair they've lost. So that being said, when you think about this type of steady downward progression, I would say it's important to at least consider, if you're a male, to consider a DHT blocker. This, again, without more details about your clinical picture, and the clinical picture that I rely on is age of onset, current age, degree of hair loss, other intervention, a history of other interventions, and the effectiveness of other interventions. The reality is that, of course, there are only a finite and small number of interventions. So, to answer the question about whether or not the PRP is really working requires more global detail of your clinical situation. I think the one thing that I can add to this that might be helpful for you to ask your physician is whether or not it is advisable to start adding a DHT blocker like finasteride to try to reduce the effect of DHT on your hair. If you have male pattern hair loss and it is 95% of hair loss is genetic pattern loss, then you might be in a situation where a DHT blocker can help improve the longevity of the hair follicles and maybe give the PRP an opportunity to actually have an effective stimulatory effect. Again, this comes from a lot of experience and many, many patients and reviewing our photos very, very carefully. Again, over 7 years of doing this and treating patients from around the world. So I think it's worthwhile to discuss this with your doctor and learn a little bit about their experience with medical and surgical treatment of hair loss and take it from there. So I hope that was helpful. I wish you the best of luck and thank you for your question.